This month, we're asking for your support through our premium programs via the Escapist Plus and YouTube memberships. Your support allows us to continue making the content we want instead of chasing algorithms or the latest trends. Plus, you get a bunch of perks like ad-free viewing via the Escapist Plus on our main website, early access on YouTube via YouTube memberships. You can even ask us questions for our Ask the Creators video series. Thanks for all your support, whether it's with these programs or your general viewership. And then I will say hi there and welcome everyone. My name is Jack Packard.
I am Bob Chipman.
I'm Darren Mooney.
And this week we are talking about a new spooky Adam Sandler Happy Madison production.
Ooh.
And I've actually forgotten his name already. Hubie Halloween.
Hubie Halloween.
Then we're going to take a look and discuss the Witches trailer, a.k.a. Everyone Hates... I messed up my joke already. I'm staying in because it's an edit point. Everybody Hates Witches. Which I know is a stretch of a pun because the trailer reminded me of Everyone Hates Chris. Because it's Chris Rock talking over a younger version.
I think we've hit rock bottom here.
Darren, you absolutely saved my pun. Thank you. And then towards the end, we will talk about the prodigal Cronenberg son's first outing with Possessor.
Second outing. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know this.
Yeah, this he had antiviral before, but it was okay.
This is why I do a podcast with you guys, because you give me all the information I need to know. Hello and welcome, everyone. This is the Escapist Movie Podcast. That's a fancy transition there. Maybe I'll do it. Maybe I won't. We'll see what happens. Yeah. We'll see how much time I have. All right. First and foremost, Hubie Halloween.
Yes.
Hubie Dubois. I'm gonna put this out here. I am, in general, a big fan of Adam Sandler, both as a comedian and as a person. I think what he brought to SNL was unique and original and unlike anything we had seen before or after. And both Billy Madison and Happy Gilmore are comedy classics, my personal favorites as far as I am concerned. That's where I stand on Adam Sandler. Bob, any thoughts on Adam Sandler?
Well, you know, I've been working up to a big project on the personal site of my own that's Adam Sandler themed, and I had a preview of that just recently about Adam Sandler movies. And I've been revisiting the first five, Billy Madison, Happy Gilmore, Wedding Singer, Big Daddy, and did I miss one? Waterboy.
Waterboy, yep.
Waterboy comes between Wedding Singer and Big Daddy. And, you know, I kind of like got like a, sort of like the biggest thing I had out for a while online was the review of Pixels, which I thought was terrible. And, you know, Adam Sandler, and I stand by that, Pixels is terrible.
Absolutely.
And, Adam Sandler has made a lot of movies, and by, you know, just by mathematics, he has made a lot of not great movies. But, by all accounts, he's a really good guy. He's was really good in Uncut Gems recently. I think Happy Gilmore is the best his best movie. I think Waterboy is underrated.
Yeah.
Wedding Singer, very good. Billy Madison holds up surprisingly well for an early movie.
Mm-hmm.
I think he does a lot of entertaining things. And, you know, yeah, so I'm an Adam Sandler fan. I will stand that. I've certainly become more of one going back through them and saying, like, you know, yeah, there really is, as I suspected, in setting out to do this, he's like, yeah, there really actually is something else here. And, you know, as we will probably talk about in the movie, I think that this is a pretty exemplar thereof. So
Darren,
yeah, that's what I got to say.
Darren, your thoughts on Adam Sandler in general, before we get into specific Hubie Halloween talk.
generally speaking, I'm agnostic on Sandler, in that, like, he wouldn't be my favorite of the wave of 90s comedians that came up. He wouldn't be my least favorite. I kind of have a bigger preference towards Ben Stiller, ironically, of all things, given that the movie we're going to talk about here. I think that he's made some genuinely great movies. I agree that Happy Gilmore is, for me, the best Adam Sandler movie in terms of the comedies that he's made. But I also, again, have a huge spot. Those five that Bob mentioned are all very strong in their own terms. And even since then, there have been occasional, like, really ones that I've enjoyed almost in spite of myself that I didn't quite expect to. Movies like Click, for example, I liked more than I thought I would. Or, you know, movies like 51st Dates as well, I enjoyed a bit more than I expected that I would. That said, I think that it's become very fashionable to kind of dump on Sandler a lot. I have a great deal of, and again, this is where I want to be very careful in how I word this, but almost respect for the fact that he seems to take care of the people around him, in that he's created a kind of a mechanism using the money that Netflix has given him to keep his friends basically employed and to keep the people who work with him. And that's not just obviously, you know, the Kevin Jameses or the Rob Schneiders of the world. It's also the directors who work behind the scenes on these movies as well. Mm-hmm. The writers who work with him on these movies and various levels of production, and found a way to basically keep them continuously employed and paid and involved. And I think that's, you know, something that I actually do almost admire about the work that he puts out. Yeah. And like, what I will say, and this is going to sound like the most backhanded compliment ever, is that even when I'm watching a terrible Adam Sandler movie, and it happens occasionally, it always looks like the people involved at least had a bit of fun making it. Like, it looks like the large part of, like, the, you know, the gag reel, which is again a relic of kind of 80s and 90s comedy and film, but the gag reel in Adam Sandler movies seem to largely exist to assure you that yes, everybody here greatly enjoyed it, and nobody was here just for the paycheck. Everybody's here because they want to be, which I find kind of like heartwarming of itself. And also the fact that because these are the biggest movies that Netflix makes, according to Netflix, and therefore entirely unverifiable by any external metric, so no way of quantifying it. But according to Netflix, these are the most popular movies that they make. They're the ones that bring subscribers to the service. Mm-hmm. And while Netflix, you know, doesn't exist in the way that normal studios or businesses do, where the amount of money you take in is comparable to the money that you spend, because they're based on that, like, abstract concept of abstract growth and taking on large amounts of debt to finance projects, I do think that Sandler, to a certain extent, arguably keeps the light on. So the fact that, you know, as we're recording this, the trailer for David Finch's Mank was released, which is a movie that I am very excited about, me and literally hundreds of other people. But I accept that, like, the flip side of getting Mank this year is that, yes, there will be an Adam Sandler movie, and it may not be great, but it's going to be something that people want to watch on the service. And I have no problem with that. So that's my very agnostic take on Adam Sandler.
And I think that's fair. Like, to me, like, Adam Sandler, both as an actor and as a creator, like, there is a spectrum to Adam Sandler. You know, it's a beautiful triangle spectrum where you have, you know, pure comedy at one end. You have him just as a genuinely good actor on another corner. And then, and this is me personally speaking, I feel like some of his movies are so bad that they can only be explained as if they were a scam. I'm looking in your direction, Jack and Jill. My friends over at Red Letter Media have a very great video about it. So, to me, to roll us into Hubie Halloween, this lies somewhere between the pure comedy and so bad it's a scam section, where, like, there are a lot of really fun comedy beats in it, but also it feels a little too much like it's just him and his friends hanging out having fun and not enough of a movie. You know, like, especially if you compare it to something like Billy Madison or Happy Gilmore, those movies are incredibly well structured. There is a high premise and a structure, and they get the gags in between the structure. Hubie is very loose. It's very improv-y, which I know is a dirty word as far as movies are concerned. But it also just feels so loose that it has no acts to speak of.
Yeah. Well, exactly it. Like, I mean, not to get... Can we spoil this movie? Is it spoilable? I'm not asking, like, etiquettely wise. I'm just asking, like, technically speaking.
I think it actually might be. I get the sense that I might have liked it a little more than you guys did, but I feel like, well, not saying that this is a really difficult to figure out mystery sort of thing. I feel like because there is a mystery plot in the movie. It's sort of doing a slasher movie. Like if this has a structure to it, it's the structure of a slasher movie that takes place on Halloween. It's not necessarily like a Halloween the series spoof, but it has the structure of that, and it has kind of a whodunit, who is the mask killer, what is going on kind of thing to it. I do think that it's possible to spoil this one because they are.
Okay.
I'll say this, that they're really playing off of, if we're not going to have too much of like character stuff in it, we'll just pack this one with story stuff, because there's a lot of, there's like 3 Scooby-Doo movies worth of Scooby-Doo business going on in this.
Yes.
With what's going on. And that's, you know, it moves. Like I was it got to the point where I thought the movie was like, must be getting near the end. Just like structure. Like I wasn't bored, like structure wise. And I checked and I was like, holy shit, we're only a half hour in. I thought this was the climax. Wow. Okay. where's this going? So I was having fun with it, but yeah, structurally it's loose as hell.
Hmm.
Here he's doing a character, which seems to be, I feel like this must have at some point been, okay, let's actually make the Canteen Boy movie. And then, and because the QB has like a utility thermos is like his comedy weapon. And it feels like it's the same voice. It's the same affect. It's the same sort of, you know, like a local loser who is like a 40-year-old Boy Scout kind of thing. And it feels like this must have been that, and then at some point they decided, okay, we'll do a Halloween movie and kick a bunch of money into the Salem Board of Tourism so that we can shoot on location there, because he always shoots on the North Shore when he can in the New England area. And turns out that's really useful this year for Salem, because there might not be that much of a Halloween because
so far as being like a Canteen Boy movie that they use, I want to say, production stills from Saturday Night Live in his Boy Scout outfit as like a backstory for Hubie.
It feels very much like that.
I suspect that might actually be a difference between myself and Bob there, because Bob mentions the Canteen Boy, and from context, because I'm not American, I'm getting that's a Saturday Night Live character that he would have played while he was on the show. And obviously Saturday Night Live is not as big over here. So, like, as far as I was aware going into it, what got me kind of vaguely excited about Hubie Halloween was the fact that it, you know, first of all, it also co-stars, you know, as the love interest. It has Julie Bowen, who worked with him on Happy Gilmore, for example. Mm-hmm. And it also, you know, so I was kind of like, is this going to be like a Happy Gilmore reunion? Are we doing kind of a Happy Gilmore thing? And it's like, no. No, we are not. And it goes straight to that level of cartoonishness, but while also trying to be quite earnest. And again, not to spoil the end of the movie, but like towards the end of the movie, there was a very sharp tonal shift where it was like, is this... And again, part of me wonders, like, the audience for Hubie Halloween. And again, this is where Jack, as a responsible parent on the podcast, is very, very useful. Do I get the sense that the target audience for Hubie Halloween is maybe younger teenagers rather than actual adults? Because it feels like a lot of what the movie's saying, and it does have a very clear moral or moral perspective or argument that it builds itself around. Is the audience for this meant to be older comedy fans, like, you know, dyed in the wool kind of Jack, or is it meant to be kind of like teenagers, or is it, where does it fall?
And like, to me, that's where the movie gets a little extra frustrating, just on a meta level, where, you know, obviously, like, there's a lot of older SNL alumni, Tim Meadows, Maya Rudolph is in it, who are wonderful and hilarious. Colin,
Quinn as the janitor.
Colin Quinn. Thank you. Yeah, yes, Colin Quinn is in it.
See, I know my SNL.
Like, even George Wallace is in it, which is like, you know, like a lot of like old comedy people are in it, which for me was really fantastic. I did choose to show this to my children to gauge their reaction. And for the most part, it's a very tame movie. It is a spooky Halloween movie, which I think is great, like great Halloween atmosphere. The Hubie character is that very standard Adam Sandler, like, I'm an idiot, but I have a heart of gold, and my heart of gold is what really matters. So it's like, it does have that weird moral message where he's basically doing a dumb guy voice, but Hubie is also played to the top of Hubie's intelligence, I think. It's wibbly wobbly. So here's where it gets frustrating for me as a parent watching this, is there were many cases in which most jokes, which were very tame, all the scare stuff was very tame, but then like there is just overt sexual jokes dropped right in the middle of this. And so, you know, having to pause the movie to explain to my children both what an asexual is and what horny is took away a little bit of the joke, obviously. Like, it was a fine conversation to have, and, you know, it's okay to be open
Adam Sandler,
with your,
you know, helping parents kind of talk to children for decades.
Right. And it's like, hey, guess what? You got to do that as a parent. You got to explain stuff sometimes. And that's not a big deal. But then like, there's like an extended 5-minute gag about blowjobs. And it's like, yeah, we don't. If that stuff would have been cut from the movie, this would have been a family classic instantly. Like, spooky enough, goofy enough. But then the weird sexual jokes, I don't quite understand it.
Yeah. And then that with the earnestness is the thing. Like, and then juxtaposing that with like the movie's insistence that, you know, is it a spoiler to talk about theme in that the film is very much interested in this idea that Hubie is bullied and picked on by Ray Liotta, which, you know, it's a long way from Goodfellas 30 years ago. But I love that they cast Ray Liotta based primarily on the fact that he has such a great asshole laugh. Like, that seems to be, like, the primary casting characteristic of Ray Liotta. He laughs like an asshole. But, like, the movie's kind of primary theme seems to be that, you know, people around Hubie, you know, they need to stop picking on him. They need to stop bullying him. They need to respect him. Because even though he's unusual, they need to accept that he means well and he's basically competent. And it's weird that that's a very child-friendly message, while also, as you pointed out, doing 5-minute blowjob bits. It's a very strange mix.
It is. And, you know, like, what I will say is that my kids were, and this was, by the way, their first Adam Sandler movie. So I'm very proud, as I enjoy Adam Sandler overall. They were very happy with it. Like, they were enjoying it. Plenty of great running gags in the joke. Plenty of great running jokes in the movie. Is that his little canteen, his thermos is a Swiss Army thermos. And every time he put out a new tool from his thermos, they were just like, what? He's got a screwdriver in there. Like, they dug the hell out of that and laughed earnestly at the jokes that were supposed to be funny. But then it's, you know, characters making out over a sandwich, and they're just like, why is this in a movie, you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a little mushy.
That's always a tough balancing act. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna, you know, I'll crib from and, you know, tonally, this it is all over the map, and a lot of the Netflix comedies that are not rigidly for adults or for that are like aiming in the family comedy zone. Like, I really feel like this is a genre that Hollywood sort of, like, in general, forgot how to make, just period. Like, movies like Beethoven, for example, which are played exactly to, you can be a kid and watch that movie and just think, hey, the dog is great, and that dog is a great protagonist, and why is Charles Grodin being such an asshole? And, like, you can watch that as, like, you know, like, a 30-year-old person or 40-year-old person or whatnot, and watch that and go, oh man, he's really trying so hard, and the dog is just ruining dinner, and it works pretty much the same way, because it works, and then eventually they're on the same side, and it's okay, like it fits, and it's sort of like how at one point Hollywood forgot how to make movies for couples, and it was like, no, men, you get your movies with guns and stuff where there is nothing going on, and women, you get romantic comedies, and that's it. and we're no longer going to make like Casablanca or African Queen where that's the same effing movie. Mm-hmm. And right. So I think that that's an issue. And in when I did the thing about Adam Sandler recently, that what I arrived at is that there was a changeover in like big budget comedies where the audience for big budget comedies became kids and teenagers in the 80s and 90s because they had the money and they were going out there. And what had happened was that the first wave of big budget comedy that like your Caddyshacks and your Ghostbusters, not necessarily huge budgets, but like huge takes at the box office, were mainly made for adults with a few fantastical elements thrown in. Like Ghostbusters is an adult comedy. Like Ghostbusters is about a bunch of middle-aged assholes who go into business. It's about Bill Murray trying to get laid and Dan Aykroyd getting blown by a ghost. You know, like Peter Venkman is a borderline rapist. Why is he carrying the drug with the needle in the? Why did he bring that on a date? You know, it's all, and like even the jokes that aren't sex jokes are jokes about paying their taxes and their mortgage and dealing with TV. All of this stuff. That, like, what does a kid give a shit about this? But they like the ghosts and stuff, and that's what they remember, and so it becomes a toy line and a cartoon. And, oh, hey, that's what the audience is. And I think that what helped Adam Sandler, Jim Carrey, Chris Farley, etc., become the successes that they were in the 90s was that they recognized, okay, this is what the audience for these movies are now, so we're still going to do adult humor, but we are going to skip right ahead and frontline, you know, the Caddyshack stuff that the kids like. So we're going to skip ahead over the class warfare stuff and the kid trying to get into college and go straight to, like, if Adam Sandler had made Caddyshack instead of Happy Gilmore, he would have played the gopher or Carl, and that would have been the main plot of the movie, and that would have been it. And I think that in the case of this one, I feel like this one aims a little more at kids than the other Adam Sandler movies. It's definitely the most kid aimed movie I think he's done probably since Bedtime Stories or the Hotel Transylvania movies, which are animated. So it's a different thing. Although, even though the Hotel Transylvania movies are mainly about a middle-aged, you know, man being, you know, having difficulty relating to his kids, and there's all of this really inside baseball humor about, you know, Jewish resort towns from the 50s going out of business, which is a whole other thing. But
right. No, but and this, I, like... Yeah. This one goes right to like the tween model, you know, like they're the main B story, the main B story. The B story is, this is how we talk sometimes. The B story revolves around a group of teenagers, like Will from Stranger Things, seen as not being scared in a dark place, which was weird for me to see. Is, you know, a freshman at a high school and trying to meet girls and navigate being cool in high school. That's the B plot. And so, like, for my 12-year-old watching this, he locked on, like, oh, my God, this is so cool. And, of course, you still get Adam Sandler getting a tuba thrown at him. So it's like... it's all sorts of funny stuff. I wish they would have picked a side and went hard there. I feel like the Netflix bloat is somehow multiplied with an Adam Sandler movie because they find themselves very funny. Keep it in. It's fine. Just keep it in.
I think, like, if I was, like, the editor or producer of this one telling them, okay, you need to dial something back, like, I probably would have said, like there's a lot of Tim Meadows and Maya Rudolph doing a bickering couple shtick that is not super... It's not really, like, with the rest of the movie. And it really... And it kind of does feel like it's... It feels like in this one, Tim Meadows is in the spot that Rob Schneider is often in Adam Sandler movies of, you know, look, you know, I don't think that the Fox sitcom that Tim Meadows was on for like a season with the cartoon is ever came back. So like Tim Meadows could use some work here's this thing because I like Tim Meadows. So like, I get it. You know, you mentioned earlier, what is the audience for this week? I think it just took me what the, like, because Sandler seems to know his audiences. I feel like the audience for this, with the callback, because, like, the specific callbacks to Happy Gilmore and Billy Madison, like, there's a character from Happy Gilmore shows up. Someone shows up and says, oh, yeah, him. Like, there's a Billy Madison shout out to, like, okay, like, something generational is still occurring in the Adam Sandler universe. If you're really old school, like, Hubie essentially is Canteen Boy as an adult man. Or adult Erman. There's quite a bit of business there. Kevin James, as ever, appears to be playing the role that Chris Farley would have played. was mm-hmm. were that still a thing, though he has a different energy than that, but still a lot of these characters. I think the audience for this is probably people are we all in similar age group? I don't know. I'm 40 this year. I don't actually know.
I'm 33.
Darren's the youngest then. I'm the baby. You're the baby. I'm 38. So yeah, we're all in, 30s, 40s. Right.
Okay,
all
right. Yeah. So I feel like the ideal audience for this is someone who is a huge fan of the classic Adam Sandler movies, mm-hmm. who wants to show an Adam Sandler movie to their kids.
So it's me. So I'm the audience for this.
Yeah,
I think
the ideal audience for this is, on top of being, I think it's a really good Halloween movie because it's like just scary enough for kids, because there is like actual serial killer stuff going on. They tease at there being a monster and they don't fully back away from it.
Right.
And like the eventual right. sort of, once they get around to, okay, no, it's not this person. No, it's not. Like the eventual sort of, oh shit, it's this person, is for a couple of minutes, a really dark scene.
It gets
funny again, like a little bit, and then as you go, okay, no, nothing bad is gonna happen. This is like, but for a minute there, it goes into like, wow, okay, this is, I didn't expect this, because this is the darkest possible place this could go, mm-hmm. and it's really something. I really think the audience for this is someone who's like, okay, yeah, kids, what up, child? This guy was really funny when I was your age, so you're going to watch this. And then in a couple of years, I'm going to show you mm-hmm. Billy Madison or Happy Gilmore, because I think that has a couple F-bombs in it. So,
And scantily clad women, yeah. So we got to be careful about that. But I think you're exactly right. I think like as like a kid's, like adding to the list of like, warm-ups to real horror movies, Hubie Halloween is a good addition. And like I think I've been really harsh on it overall, like it's a perfectly fine movie. I don't think it goes into full this is just a scam territory. I don't think it's their best work as far as comedies are concerned, but all of the spooky Halloween elements are so wonderful. It has that Halloween feeling. Like you said, it's in Salem. It's Halloween day. There's people in costumes and fall colored leaves. That's fantastic.
And speaking of someone who goes to Salem all the time during this time of year, not so much this year, but this is the first one, because a lot of movies do the we're set in Salem thing and none of them get it right. And because it's a lot of them make it look too not tacky. if if you saw the movie Paranorman, which is a Salem-like town, and that they've sort of like commercialized a witch burning, which is actually a kind of horrible event in their town. When that came out, I interviewed the guys who animated that, who made the Laika people as part of group thing. I mean, so I was like, so did you guys like go to Salem to get the ideas? And they said, funny story, we wrote this as a parody of what we imagine that must be like. And then we went to Salem and said, oh, God damn it, we have to rewrite the movie because this is so much more extreme than what we thought the parody of this would be. So basically Hubie Halloween and Elvira are the movies that got this right. Like a lot of people like Hocus Pocus. I'm sorry, 90s kids. It's not a good movie. I'm sorry. I know you really enjoy Bette Midler and the hot version of Sarah Jessica Parker, and Kathy the Jimmy is a very funny lady. But like that Hocus Pocus isn't good. I'm sorry. I know Bette sings and it's got like, and I know you might have like discovered what a zombie is there. The movie's not actually good. I'm sorry. But
listen, we were all forced to sing The Wind Beneath My Wings in grade school, so we have to love Bette Midler forever.
No, it's fine. But like they made that in Salem and it doesn't really get it right. But like this and the Elvira movie from the 80s that nobody saw nailed it. So yeah. I'll give it that. And thanks for sending a bunch of money to Salem, Adam, because it turns out they needed it this year.
Absolutely. All right. That feels like a wrap for Hubie Halloween. Pretty funny, If you can skip forward 10 or 15 seconds at a few key moments, perfectly fine to show to kids.
Or 5 minutes for that extended blowjob gag.
It's what's with the blowjob? Like, I get it. You're trying to be funny, but just cut it out. God, Gosh dang it. All right.
It really sucks.
You
don't watch the podcast with your kids.
You will. Well, I think, you know, speaking of something like Hocus Pocus, something like family-friendly, child-appropriate, spooky movies, that's a perfect segue into The Witches. And along with Hocus Pocus, I feel like there is a nostalgia cloud over the original adaptation of The Witches, which is overall a very boring movie with some really fun elements to it. And I think everyone remembers the witch transformation scene and like the 5 minutes of fun mouse stuff and forgets about the rest of the movie, which is kind of boring. I'm sorry.
Yeah, there's a lot of walking around a hotel in that. And, you know, Stanley Kubrick had to make a fake hotel that was inherently scary to make a hotel interesting, because hotels are not designed to be interesting outside of the lobby. They're designed to be banal and comfortable and safe. And I mean, the Witches is, it's a fascinating relic, because at a certain point, like, was that a Disney thing when that first happened?
It was Warner Brothers
gave a bunch of money to the Disney people and Nicholas Reg, who is not a family filmmaker or a Jim Henson person in any way, and said, sure, adapt, you know, Roald Dahl's least thinly veiled anti-Semitic screed and creepiest book by far into, you know, something we can release as a family movie, and they still made it like that. And a bunch of people took their kids to it who had no business watching this movie, which is equally parts boring and horrifying.
Okay. Hold on. Now, I feel the need, first of all, to defend The Witches here, because I would argue The Witches is actually quite good. And again, maybe this is a cultural thing, because this is a very, like, British Isles movie. I am Irish, oh, yes, not British, absolutely, to be clear. But that discussion of hotels being boring... I wonder, like, you guys live in America, so I wonder, like, what your childhood holidays were like, where you literally hop in a car and can drive, you know, and there's just land everywhere. Whereas if you're in Ireland or the British Isles, it's like, well, you're going to move from one wet, damp, green, vaguely grey place to another wet, damp, green, vaguely grey place. And the only change is going to be that when you go down in the morning, you'll get, like, a little French bread that's stale. And, you know, somebody in a tweed jacket and a suit is going to sneer at you because, you know, you're not the regular customers here. Like, as somebody who, like, spent his childhood doing, like, the mobile home and the caravan and the kind of hotel and kind of family trips that were, like, again, obligatory, we're getting out of the house because the kids are on holiday type of holiday. I think The Witches actually does capture that sense. In the sense in which you're a kid wandering around the hotel, there's literally one other kid and there's a conference there that's populated by adults who are probably up to no good, but are, you know, if you're an adult, you're well aware that they're just doing boring stuff.
Right.
I actually think that aspect of the film works remarkably well, or at least kind of worked remarkably well for me as a kid and rewatching it today. And I actually genuinely adore that it retained that oddness to it, that oddness of it being like, let's get the guy who did Don't Look Now and The Man Who Fell to Earth, give him carte blanche, let him hire Angelica Houston, who, by the way, last played a witch in The Witches of Eastwick. Was she in The Witches of Eastwick, if I remember correctly? Am I misremembering? No, she wasn't.
I think Cher was the brunette.
Cher was, and Jack Nicholson is, and that's where I'm getting the connection wrong. Apologies. But yeah, you know, she's literally at this time married to Satan from The Witches of Eastwick.
Right.
Let's get her in. And like repeatedly throughout, apparently during production, like Nicholas Rogue would send messages and notes on costuming for her and say, it's not sexy enough. It needs to be sexier. If you want to confuse the young men in the audience even more when the face peeling begins. But I kind of admire the way in which it goes there, because this is very much... And again, this is probably me as a product of the kid, you know, as a kid of the late 80s, early 90s. Mm-hmm. This is one of the great Stranger Danger movies in that, that's pretty much all it is. I mean, Bob is quite right. Mm. Roald Dahl's original screed is very anti-Semitic and also slightly misogynistic. Because I think when he went his... Just a little bit. Now, to be fair, he does clarify that there are male ghouls. We're just not going to talk about them in this book. I think his daughter, like during press for Matilda the Musical, actually came out and said the character of the Grand High Witch was based on her stepmother. So, you know, let's not Ooh. Get... Yeah.
No. First of all, nice.
Yes. Roald Dahl, classy. Let's just say Roald Dahl, classy.
But subtlety is for cowards.
Yeah. But like
was her stepmother Patricia Neal?
I don't know.
The actress. Oh, wow. Yeah. I'm forgetting what order he was married in because Patricia Neal at that point, best known for having like played the female lead in The Fountainhead.
Oh.
Oh. Okay, oh, so, no. Maybe. Yeah, so maybe. So what I will say though is that like, as a child watching it in the late 80s, early 90s, this was the era of Stranger Danger. And this was the era where you were constantly being told by your parents that you could not leave their sights or you would be abducted by bad people and bad things would happen to you. Yeah. And the news was full of stories of kids who had disappeared. And like, I remember watching it as a kid and being like, this is the thinnest veneer that we could possibly put on the fear that if you're out playing and a stranger talks to you, you're going to end up trapped in a van and terrible things are going to happen to you.
Yeah.
And like, I admire the movie for going there because it's very much, and again, it's the Nicholas Rogue thing where Rogue, when he did Don't Look Now, it's very much as an adult fear. It's a fear of like, you know, a couple who have lost a child and dealing with the emotional fallout of that. I love that the witches takes that approach and says, yes, but what if instead of terrorizing middle-class, middle-aged married couples, I applied the lessons that I used there to scare the shit out of 10-year-olds. And it's like, yeah, it works. Like, that logic actually works. Because it's the same logic that drives, you know, Red Riding Hood. It's the same logic that drives, you know, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, the child catcher from that. And I think that I think it works remarkably well. And I think rewatching it today, I was surprised at how committed it goes to it, to the point where, as an adult, I'm picking up on stuff that I wouldn't have picked up on as a child that should have freaked me out more.
Yeah.
Like the death of the parents and the grandmother's diagnosis and the realization that, you know, you're not really going to be around long enough to see your parents die or whatever. That's sort of like very much kind of like I'm aware as a child that terrible things are happening. So I really, really like The Witches.
Yeah, I think it's a fascinating relic. It's I don't know that it works, but it's one of those things where it's like I'm glad this exists because it's so uniquely itself.
Yeah. No, and again, you know, for like those like introductions to spooky movies, to horror movies, the witch transformation sequence in the original The Witches is terrifying and wonderful if you're a fan of that sort of thing. And so for a kid, I know when I was a kid and later showing it to my own kids, watching that and just reveling in the witches becoming the witches, it's a beautiful thing. And then of course you're a funny mouse kid, it's, you know, but that's fine. And so
puppetry,
like, for me to roll this a little bit into the new The Witches, which is going to be premiering on HBO Max later this month, starring Anne Hathaway. We have Robert Zemeckis at the head. We have co-written by Guillermo del Toro. We have a ton of really interesting talent. Anne Hathaway as the head high witch. Very, very interesting. I'm very excited for what a modern take on this is going to be with a little... You know, obviously, I don't know if we've loosened up or become more conservative as movie makers and moviegoers, but we now have the technology to make this even more terrifying and smooth out some of the unevenness that I thought was in the original adaptation. Forgot to mention another co-writer is Kenya Barris, who is a mainstay Black-ish writer. I don't know.
Yes.
You guys watch that particular sitcom, but they're very well known there in Black-ish for doing their homages to nostalgia properties. So I think it's very exciting for me, at least.
Yeah, I'm interested to see where it goes. I'm interested to see what their angle is. Mm. You know, when I the quickest way, and I feel like I'm a traitor to my generation and to my younger self, is that the quickest way to make me feel like, oh God, this is going to be a chore, is to tell me that Robert Zemeckis is directing a movie. And I feel really bad about that, but like, he has made a lot of bad movies over the last like 20 years or so.
I'm going through his IMDb
so,
right
Polar
now.
Polar Express, in which Tom Hanks is everyone.
Oh, crap.
Welcome to Marwen from last year, which is one of the most fucked up things I have ever seen. I've seen a lot. I've watched like Japanese horror and it still scarred me.
You know what's amazing about Welcome to Marwen is that Welcome to Marwen should be, was probably always going to be a disaster because the premise and the cast and the director, everything is mismatched in a story that was probably never going to work, and yet somehow it's a really, anemic, flat slog that I can't even be angry or shocked about. That movie should have been so bad people were burning down the theaters, and it was just kind of like,
what I'll say about Welcome to Marwen, I actually think it was that so bad that it's not good, but it's at least interesting, because there's a moment where the main character is confronted by the anthropomorphized personification of his trauma, which instructs him to build a time machine, and we get a montage set to the Dandy Warhols. And it's just like, what the hell is going on here? Who let this happen? Why would you make these choices? And it's
I'm looking back here, and he did the Christmas Carol, the animated Jim Carrey one, Beowulf. Oh,
I'm here to kill your monster. Well, to be fair, this will be shot using real actors, but yes, there will be a lot of CGI, which is what makes me a bit trepidatious about it.
Yeah,
anxious when Robert Zemeckis.
Flight and Beowulf are probably the high end of the recent ones, and he was obsessed with the motion capture thing about 20 years before people figured out how to make it good, and
sure.
I think Beowulf has a really interesting script, so it's an effort.
It's
so it's taken its shot. I think this. When I heard the casting, and I heard, okay, all right, what are we doing? All right, okay, Chris Rock, okay, cool. All right, who's playing the grandma? Oh, okay, all right, okay. Mm-hmm. So how are they casting the witches? Because Zemeckis doesn't do subtle, so how are we casting the witches? Is this going in a direction that I think we're... Okay, yeah, all right, so that's where we're going. Okay, all right, so they've decided to not even try to recreate the uniquely English anti-Semitism of Roald Dahl which is probably for the best.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for that, because there's no way to recreate, I think, the aesthetic of the original, because I think that the sources he was drawing on, both benign and also not so benign for the reference pool he was using, I think if you just do that now, I think
people will realize what it is.
Well, not only realize what it is, even if they don't, they'll point at it and go, wait a minute, this is a QAnon movie. they'll just point at it and go, wait a minute, there's an evil cult led by a charismatic female politician that's eating children to stay young. This is about Comet Pizza, and this is going to and that would be what it is. So it's probably if you're gonna have people mad at your movie anyway, it's probably best to say no. The witches are white, and they're gonna devour black children to stay young, and that's what we're doing now. Because Hollywood took exactly the wrong lesson away from Get Out, which is if you make your movie a really heavy-handed race metaphor, that's how you make a horror-themed thing that makes $1 billion. But we had Antebellum seemed to be running on that that's how you pitch a horror movie now. Not that this is horror, but it's kids
kid friendly horror
stuff. But
this is spooky. Yeah.
I'm interested in seeing where it goes with that. There's no read between the lines way to say that I really wish that Zemeckis would start doing coke again. because like his
Come
because,
on.
Well no because like 80 well no like I here's the thing. Like, I wish every, and not, I wish that there was a non-harmful to their health and physical well-being way for all of the, like, madcap, I don't care if I wake up tomorrow energy that all of these, like, the film school brat generation filmmakers that were just roaring engines of creativity of the late 70s into the mid 80s had, that I wish they could get back without destroying their brains.
Right. Because, like, okay, there we go. That's a good way to put it.
Right. Because when you ask, you know, hey, why were 80s movies, even the mainstream ones, so effing nuts? How did the Monster Squad get greenlit? Why is there an actual violent mafia family gang as the antagonists of the Goonies? It doesn't need this. Why is there all of this stuff that's like misogyny, all these things? And it's like everyone in LA was doing mountains of cocaine to wake up in the morning, and all of those decisions were getting made, and that was the way the country was being run until everything crashed into a wall into the 1989, and eventually we elected Bill Clinton and needed to, and everyone said, you know what, chill,
let's just settle down,
he's gonna play some jazz sax and we're all gonna chill and, and just have 10 years of moderate chill.
And so, Kenny G ruined everything with lulling saxophone. Absolutely.
Well, the end of mutually assured destruction didn't help. Like, you know, once
existential threat was just gone.
Once the Russians weren't going to blow us up like tomorrow every day, you know, and we had no reason to say fuck it. You know what? Dracula and Frankenstein are going to fight the Goonies, and it's going to be awesome.
Like, the little kid's going to kick the Wolfman in his balls. Go.
Yeah. Like once we had that, pitching family movies just got much less interesting. So, I'm not Bob. Fellow Bob Zemeckis, because we have met at least once, interview you on flight, very nice guy. You know, he has no idea who I am. Bob Zemeckis, I am not asking you to do cocaine again. Have you thought about Adderall?
It's very nice. Keeps you going all day. Make sure you get your prescription right, though, or else you feel a little funny.
Yeah. I'm kind of more in the, like, I'm glad Bob Zemeckis is working. I just don't feel like he has, like, I feel like he gets, like, a blank check to coast. I'm agnostic on the witches. I'm like, you know, maybe it'll be good, maybe it'll be bad. I'm going to watch it anyway. It's one of those things where adapting it to an American context and hiring Bob Zemeckis of all American directors to do it screams to me of, like, the difference between making this movie now and making it in 1990. Like, where it feels like, you know, if you were a studio, the way that you would do it in the 1990s is you would find, or that coming out of the 80s, you go, oh, yeah, hey, he's, you know, this is a guy, he's done some interesting, weird stuff that I absolutely loved. Let's get him to do it. And, you know, sure, we can fix it in post if he comes back with something completely crazy. As opposed to here, it's like, oh, yeah, you know, Bob, he's been around here for 40 years. Hasn't made a good movie in, you know, 30 of those, but we really love that one. So, yeah, kids will dig it.
I'm going back to find exactly how long it's been since he's made a good movie. Hold on.
We're quantifying this bad boy.
Ooh, okay. You know what? This might be putting me out on a limb here. I still like overall Contact. I think Contact's a fine movie. That's 97.
Sweet, yeah.
So 97 is 23 years. It's been 23 years since he's made a good movie.
Yeah. Okay, I apologize to Bob Zemeckis.
I don't hold the fact that Castaway gave away the end of Castaway in the trailer for Castaway against Castaway.
Oh, I suppose, yeah, Castaway's a good movie. You know what? That one slipped past me. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
So it's only been 20 years since you've made a good movie. That's fine.
But it's still kind of a while, but it's at least he didn't do Forrest Gump 2. Like he said no to Forrest Gump 2. So so they eventually did not do that.
America's most loved best picture winner.
Yeah. Hmm. We're not perfect. No shit, I know, but...
no, that was great.
I feel like Anne Hathaway is a little young for this part.
Interesting. I think she has the poise play this part, and you know, obviously, like, compare her to Angelica Houston, who played the part in the original, and I think, like, they have the equal amount of poise. Angelica Houston has always had that... I don't know how to put this politely, you know,
yeah.
you know, I'm a married man, so it's like I can't go too into detail, but Angelica Houston has always had that extra element that I don't think Anne Hathaway has. But Anne Hathaway doesn't have what Angelica Houston has, but casting directors really think she does.
I was actually kind of curious about this. Part of me wonders, is that part of, and again, sorry about generalizing about American audiences, American filmmaking, but is that kind of part of the, we're making this with an American filmmaker in the 2010s, 2020s, which is the idea that this is a kid's movie. You can't have somebody being horny in a kid's movie.
I would be very surprised if the, I don't think that there is a, like, a polite, I don't think there's a polite company way I don't think the gentle sprinkling of implied pederasty that hangs over the wishes. Yeah, are we gonna have to cut that?
I don't know what pederasty means.
Child abuse.
Oh, okay. Oh, thank you. Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. I don't think that the conflation the red version even more, because like in the doll book, it's not even really there. This is straight up the Jews are going to eat your children to become young. The movie really makes them much more vampires than witches, where this is, you know, it goes much more in the direction of the Hansel and Gretel, the literal seduction of the innocent, and goes all the way by having Angelica Houston, you know, be this sort of like, you know, seduction figure, sort of. And which is why she's played significantly older than the young boys, because we're, you know, playing up like, you know, the
Mrs. Robinson.
Yeah, the Mrs. Robinson.
Ooh, that's the polite way to put it.
Jesus Christ, I jumped right over the nice, safe Freudian word and went right to light dusting of pederasty. What the fuck is wrong with me? I agree with Darren. I do not get the sense that even though. Since the age group that this would probably be pointed at is like young enough to have like, you know, grown up with Anne Hathaway kind of hovering in their area as the live action Disney princess person, is probably like exactly in the right point for that to like be the, it's like, I don't understand why this is scary, but also not, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be an important part of my adolescence. Yeah. So I don't know if they're going to do that, but I really don't think that they're going to have Anne Hathaway behaving vaguely toward the young victim characters in the way that Angelica Houston was in the other one, especially because the minute it's in the trailer, someone is going to post a screen grab on YouTube, and they will be dealing with the bullshit that I have on my YouTube channel for the last 3 days because I said that Netflix wasn't involved in an international child kidnapping conspiracy.
Yeah.
How dare you?
Oh, yeah. That's fun.
Well, I did want to mention that when we talked about Hubie Halloween. Hubie Halloween is arguably as much child sexualization as Cuties, I would contend, but that's a separate debate. But what I do, that's the thing.
Have fun in the comment section, everybody.
I know. Darren just taking the pin and the grenade and just throwing it
what
in there.
What are you doing?
Yeah. Jack made me say it. Jack asked me to say that, just so we're clear. But anyway.
Wow.
I'm taking you with me, Jack. But no, more to the point, what I would say about like the witches is that like, I think Bob's right, they won't do that. And part of me is like, and I want to make this clear, I am saying this as 10-year-old Darren, not 33-year-old Darren, but as 10-year-old Darren watching the movie, that Mrs. Robinson element, because that's the phrase I'm going to use to describe it, was part of what was so threatening and scary about it. It was a movie that seemed like it was, again, this thing where we talk, I think when we talked about, I can't remember which film it was, but we talked about it talking up to children rather than down to children, where even as a 10-year-old, I didn't necessarily get those undertones exactly, but the fact that they were there was uncomfortable for me, and uncomfortable for me in a way that was unsettling and horrifying in more than just, oh, look, the fat kid's a mouse now. Oh, wow. That's something that I have to worry about. And I feel like you lose something if you take that away. And I feel like you kind of condescend to kids if you take that away. Although Bob's right, you're not condescending to kids. You're worried about an online hate mob. Slightly different thing.
I mean, I'm
but
sure
still,
that, yeah.
yeah.
I'm sure there's other ways to do it, but
that's,
like
that's fair.
Going, if they aren't going to go for the, oh, this person seems nice and, you know, vaguely welcoming, and oh no, actually she's a monster, like, that's the point of this character. Mm-hmm. So like, where are you going to go other than the stunt casting of, hey, look, Anne Hathaway is literally our only actress who
has played Disney Princess.
Who basically doesn't publicly debase herself in, like, she doesn't go on reality TV shows and take a pie in the face, you know, to promote the movie. You know, like, she actually campaigned for an Oscar and said, no, actually, I think I was pretty good in this movie. And I, like, she conducts herself with what counts as a modicum of class. Mm-hmm. God damn it. And so, like, she's basically known differently from other actresses of her peer group for not pretending to fall down on the red carpet because it's cute and girlish. Yeah. And, like, that means that she is playing every young actress who seems like an old Hollywood actress role that they can find, and that's why she's in this.
Yeah, that's fair.
So, you know, go, and, you know, go get your money, you know, go for it. I hope it works. I feel like if they thought that it was going to, it would not be going to HBO Max right now.
I have a slight question about this, because I am international press, so I received contact. I didn't hear about The Witches through the American channel. I heard about it through the British and Irish office of Warner Brothers.
Okay.
And the messaging on that was it will be releasing soon. Now, HBO Max is not available outside the United States. A couple of weeks ago when we were talking about streaming, we speculated that it would only be a matter of time before we saw somebody, and we speculated it would probably be Disney. It could just as easily be Warner Brothers, given that they did Tenet, which was the other half of the experiment, that we would see somebody releasing on digital in the United States and releasing in cinemas where it's viable to do so. And I wonder if The Witches is being treated as a trial balloon for that, because it's still kiddie-friendly enough that it falls under the bracket of movies that have been broadly successful on streaming. So movies like Trolls World Tour, or movies like Scoob, for example, or arguably even, you know, sort of other movies in that vein. But it's also like a live-action thing, and it also might play well in cinemas, because I think stars play better outside America now, which is somewhat ironic. So I think that Anne Hathaway might actually be a bigger draw outside the States for a cinema audience than she is inside the States. So I'm kind of curious if that makes sense, if that's the approach that we'll see.
It could be. It could very well be. I didn't check, actually. I should have. Is it going to HBO Max as a premium thing, like Mulan, or is it going as a... So it's just going to just
it's
show
just part
up
of,
the rest of the
October 22nd as part of the package. Yeah, so you're not paying any extra for it. So
that's the Artemis Fowl release.
Yeah, that's fair. The Hamilton release, the other side of that. Although this is not Hamilton. Let's be clear, this is not Hamilton.
Right.
No, they paid too much for this. I think, you know, what we've also seen as far as the video on demand release versus theater release is if they think it can make money, they're pushing back.
Yeah.
They are not video on demand releasing. And so I think this is a band-aid. This is a band-aid hoping to keep the dam close enough intact for when eventually they can break it open. And maybe they wanted this to be in theaters, but they're saying, hey, let's get it out there. We need something, because we need one little thing every month to keep people in our subscription service. Give them this. That's fine.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe The Witches is, it was, you know, this or Wonder Woman. And Warner Brothers had to drop something because, Disney's probably going to throw Soul onto the service and probably not as a premium thing.
Yeah.
Black Widow is probably going to end up there. Just, like, at this point, it's been too long. I feel like it's been too long, and it might be time to get it on there, unless they finish the Falcon and Winter Soldier and the numbers on WandaVision are incredible.
All right, let's move on now to Possessor.
Uncut.
Oh, yes. Shit. I am a lowly citizen. I am not part of the movie press, and so I haven't seen Possessor, as it is not out on video on demand. And so I will turn this over to Bob and Darren. Think of me as a moderator who will try to interrupt even less than professional moderators. Topical joke. So, Bob, Darren, Possessor, you know, obviously Cronenberg is a huge name, not just in film, but in horror film, specifically body horror film. And so there are some rather large, goopy boots to fill.
There are.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And arguably, like, I think one of the interesting things about Brandon Cronenberg is the fact that, like, you imagine when you are somebody who's emerging from the shadow of somebody who has, you know, as large, as influential as David Cronenberg on body horror, you're like, maybe I want to get as far away from that as possible. I think one of the great things about the fact that David Cronenberg has made one of the great transitions, like, just not necessarily in terms of quality, but in terms of, like, scale and artistry and, like, managing your brand, where Cronenberg went from being the guy who, like, put a vagina that receives video cassettes on James Wood's chest to making, you know, Best Picture nominated film starring Viggo Mortensen.
Yeah.
You know, the fact that, like, Cronenberg has moved into a sphere that's perhaps a bit more prestigious and a bit more respected and a bit more mainstream in his older age, a bit more kind of prestige picture, has meant that there's a vacancy there. And it means that perhaps Brandon Cronenberg doesn't feel as much like he's taking up the father's mantle or existing in his shadow. Because it's kind of interesting because these feel very much oddly like the movie that you would expect 80s David Cronenberg to be making now. And I say these movies, I'm referring to his previous feature film, Antiviral, which was released a couple of years ago, and obviously Possessor, which we're talking about today. And very, very briefly, in case listeners are not aware or watchers are not aware, Possessor is an abstract hitman movie about bodyjacking. It's basically the extent of it. It follows a professional assassin who, as part of her bag of tricks, hops into the body of somebody else, commits an assassination, and then jumps out after killing the body in question, therefore allowing for plausible deniability. That's the plot. That's basically the bones of this kind of 90-minute movie. That's all you need to know. And it serves as a vehicle for a variety of things, and I'm very curious what Bob kind of thought about some of these things, that are, I think, interesting, engaging, and perhaps at points perhaps spreads itself a little too thin, but thematically in terms of what it's dealing with and what it's biting off. But it's also just a vehicle for, like, showcasing Cronenberg as a director of body horror. There is some fantastic practical effects work. There is some amazing Foley work. Like, I think we undervalue, like, how skillfully it takes to make the sound of a knife, like, plunging into something. Sound that kind of haunts you throughout the film as much as any blood or any splatter that you see. In fact, actually, like, if you read interviews with the editor and cinematographer, like, the host of stuff is like, Cronenberg apparently just watched videos on YouTube and was like, I want to put that in my movie. Like, apparently he discovered that it's possible to make it look like water is flowing backwards on screen while watching a science video on YouTube. He's like, yes, that's going in my psychodrama about an assassin who body hops. I don't care if it fits or not. This is going to be part of it. And, like, it works really well on that level. It's a really great visceral experience. The blood flows freely. The sound is kind of almost as stomach-churning as what you see on screen. He casts it tremendously well. He casts Andrea Riseborough as Tasha Vosh, who's the lead character. And she, despite the fact the movie largely eschews, like, exposition and dialogue and, like, articulating what it's saying and how the mechanics of its world work, the fact that you're staring at Riseborough, who's always a very expressive actor, means that the movie works remarkably well because she's able to do that thing that great genre actors are, which is, this script doesn't actually give me, like, proper motivation, doesn't have me articulated, doesn't give me an Oscar clip. How do I communicate that to the audience? Like, well, you're an actor. It's like, okay, fine, I'm gonna do it. And she does. So I really, really liked it. I thought perhaps it was a bit broad in terms of, like, thematic dynamics. I think, you know, it gestures towards things like privacy and kind of, like, corporate control and, you know, hyper-capitalism, all the stuff that you would arguably expect the son of David Cronenberg to be interested in doing. But I think that it's more interesting as a kind of, like, a psychodrama body horror, to the point where, like, it almost seems like there's this recurring motif where it's treated as method acting, what Tasha Vosh does. It's like, your performance was excellent today. Or it's like, we gave you a gun. Why did you use a knife? It's like, well, it felt like it was more in character. And it's like, wow, okay. we're just going there. There's a moment where, like, Jennifer Jason Leigh, who has not hopped into another body in the movie at this point, says, you know, I look at my body in the mirror, and I don't recognize it anymore. And it's like, I see what you're going for, body horror metaphor. Aren't we all trapped in alien bodies eventually? And I kind of like, I like it. It's like a celebration of body horror, and it works well in that sense. But Bob, what about yourself? Sorry.
Yeah, I am probably going to have to watch this twice to, or a little more to really wrap my head around it. Not because I thought it was hard to figure out. In fact, midway through, it kind of clicked and I was like, wait a minute. Oh, okay. No, I'm overthinking this. This is actually because it has the trappings of something that should be like really hard to figure out because it's, let's not mince words. The reference point here would like, if this wasn't made by someone whose last name is Cronenberg and it's not just a coincidence, it's his kid. Like this would be, what if David Cronenberg made a Christopher Nolan movie would be, or like specifically, what if he made Inception?
Inception. Yeah.
And it's sort of like that because it is this kind of, here's a familiar ish, almost cyberpunk concept. But as reworked as a metaphor for a piece of filmmaking or storytelling, because not Christopher Nolan, made by someone who has not like surgically severed their anal cranial fixation. So
That's a big word.
Wow. That is
hyphenated? I think that's hyphenated. Hold on, I'm going to Google that.
I'm going to lean back here.
I didn't even write that one down. I'm just naturally pretentious. And so like it's because it literally is like, as he was describing, it is a movie about an indeterminate near future that sort of looks like a retro future because that used to be expensive to do. And now it's actually pretty easy. Just go down to the Salvation Army and pick up technology from a couple of years ago and put wood finish on it. And now you're doing retro future and it looks cool. And you just make all of your tech look like an Atari 2600. And now it's an art film. And about people who are paid by corporations to, you know, put themselves into other people's bodies and pilot them, basically, and, you know, possess them. Ooh, like the title. And then cut them. Right, yeah.
Unlike the title.
Yeah. In order to do corporate espionage, and that seems to be about, presumably there, like it's hinted that it's being used for other purposes out in this world, and if it were bigger or a TV show, we'd be seeing that, like people must also be using this to do what in real life would be the only use for this. But, you know, like in this movie, people are using it to do corporate espionage, basically, and she's really good at that. Yeah. So she goes and takes over these wives and kills them. But it's spoiled her relationships with what used to be her family because she stays in too long and can't quite, like, oh, hey, I've still got this person's memories in my head. I forgot where that person ended and I began because we're talking about acting and such. But it's, instead of being very headspacey and people folding pieces of paper and doing, like, hand puzzles and Rubik's Cubes to explain this, it's done with pistol fights and up close knife fights where people's brains get blown over the walls and pulled apart and yanked out because there's, you know, like practical special effects of guts being reshaped and reformed and splattered around because you got to do the family name proud. So that's what we're doing. You know, it's like when Cronenberg Senior remade The Fly, you know, the original Fly is like, oh, we're existential. He's got like the head of a fly in a hand. And it's about the thing about it. It's like, no, he's going to very slowly morph into a garbage eating pustule of fly guts. And that's what the movie's about, guys. but it's pretty cool. I'm going to need to watch it twice because I had to watch it on a screener on my phone. And therefore, I think I might have missed some nuance as to, like, because it feels like there's a little bit of, oh, okay, that's what that look was about. Because there's some, again, without, because I don't want to spoil, because it hasn't fully been released for everyone yet. There's, this goes, the thrust part plot of the movie is that she goes in to do an espionage on this one guy. And it's not like they're in, like, two different universes. These are people who live in basically the same city as her. So theoretically, they could meet on the street if she wasn't killing them afterwards to jump back out. And after completing the mission, she seems to decide to stay in there and continue going about this guy's life and interacting with people he knows beyond the parameters of a mission, and also running into people that she knows. And she is not supposed to have access to his memories, so she has to, like, make up and perform as him based on information. It's like, oh, right, yeah, my father, that thing we did this weekend, yeah, of course, yeah, that's my favorite shirt, of course. But also, maybe she does know things, and maybe she doesn't, and there's, like, scenes where we switch out the actor in both clever shot clip ways, where it's like, oh, hey, someone's wearing that, oh, hey, look, Andrew Ricebro's here now, and also other ways where, oh, wow, okay, that's an interesting prosthetic, all right, cool. And a lot of, there's a lot of odd stuff going on in this, most of which seems to be in camera practical effects, which is really interesting for something like that, because there's a lot of stuff you could do here with CGI that mostly seems to be done with clever prosthetics, trick editing, and like moving the camera and then moving the camera back and having someone jump in and out of frame that actually looks very clever. And it's I thought it was really interesting, but also like it's, I don't want to say it's less interesting than I thought it would be, because it's, what's interesting about it is that it continually keeps going, no, no, this is this, like, yes, there's a metaphor here, but the movie is not necessarily abstract or a metaphor. In the end, this is, like, we're telling you, this is a movie about an assassin who may or may not be too deep undercover and needs to get, you know, maybe pulled out or not. And that's about it. Like, it's, it's
okay. All right.
Like, you're thinking, is this Inception? And you're like, oh no, this is Total Recall. Okay. All right. Okay. This, like I thought it was gooey Inception, but it's gooier Total Recall. All right. Okay. All right.
I don't even think it's like Total Recall. Total Recall has a level of kind of, and again, I'm not sure, are we allowed to swear on here? Mind fuckery. Basically,
I've been swearing, I think, every episode.
Fair point. But like I think that like Total Recall has a level of kind of abstraction to it that even this doesn't, because it's like Possessor, you mentioned that it has metaphors. It has different metaphors in every scene. Like there's an extended sequence where undercover she goes to work as Colin Tate, who's infiltrating this Amazon-esque company. And it's like for a scene, it's like, oh yeah, it's about invasion of privacy. And that's a metaphor for what she's doing here. It's voyeurism. It's this idea of kind of inserting yourself in. It's what you put out into the world and what everybody can take back out. It's like identity theft, man. But it's also large corporations doing it and mining it for data. And it's like, that's a 3-minute scene. And it's like, no, we're back to method acting. That's what this is about.
There's allegory in the plot, but like the plot never, like in Inception eventually says, yeah, guys, the plot doesn't matter. We're telling you a metaphor about our process of screenwriting. Whereas this is always like, no, this is an allegory for acting, but there actually is a plot going on here about a corporate spy. And that's the main thrust of the movie. And that's it. Like eventually, it's similar. I don't want to keep going back to his father, but like he really is making films similar to what his father would have made, which is fine. But it really is like Existenz, where like, I won't spoil the end of Existenz, but once you get to the end of Existenz, it makes perfect sense. Like it makes perfect literal. No, this is what happened every step of the way. And this is what was going on. There is no like question about the reality.
Yeah, there's no ambiguity or clever solving of this.
This is what happened at the end. It's like one of those Twilight Zones that doesn't have a think about it. You know, it's like some of the Twilight Zones are like, think about the nature of man or God. And some of them are like, I'm Rod Serling. Sometimes people are actually dolls. Isn't that weird?
You guys are doing an incredible job of selling me on this. I really appreciate that. I cannot wait until eventually this comes out to where all of us normies can watch it.
It'll be out at the start of November, actually, just after Halloween on video on demand. Great.
And they're calling it uncut, and I'm not sure that there is a cut version of this movie.
That was my question.
I think that's literally just marketing. I think that's just because the gory stuff is like portioned out with large segments of not gory stuff. So I feel like Neon, which really knows how to market when they've got an art film that's also a movie that that like the midnight movie audience can latch onto. Like they had that the oh shoot, I love this movie and I forgot about it, so never mind. But well, I forgot the title. But like when Neon has a movie that they know is a good movie that's also a good Midnight Gorehound movie, they know how to promote it. So I feel like they just said, you know what? Stick Uncut on the end of this so that so people will know that this is, like, let's pretend that someone tried to censor this low-budget movie that no one was releasing but us.
Yeah. No, like, it has an opening text that says this movie is unaltered from its original presentation. It's like, this is its original presentation.
Yeah. Well, and, like, that's the thing. The IMDb listing for this is Possessor Uncut, original title, Possessor. So, like, just the name is Possessor Uncut. And I was really confused if that was the name or if it's just Possessor and it is uncut. In which case, it hasn't come out yet, so it doesn't have a cut to come out yet.
Yeah. It's
okay. All right.
It's like a Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song. Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song, the where he submitted it, and they said, yeah, we're not going to give you a rating. So this was the Blaxploitation movie, Mario Melvin Van Peebles. For people watching who aren't aware of this, because I'm very old and this was made even before I was born, but Melvin Van Peebles submits the movie to the before the MPAA, and they said, yeah, this is too violent, we're not going to give you a rating, so you're gonna have to release it as rated X. So he released it as rated X by an all-white jury.
All right, well, great, that was a fantastic conversation. Thank you all for listening and or watching to the Escapist Movie Podcast. Yeah. Once again, I've been Jack Packard.
Bob Chipman.
Darren Mooney.
This week with less technical hiccups, thanks to Zoom.
Zoom! I don't know if that's like Zoom's catchphrase or something. I just like saying
that's exactly Zoom's catchphrase.
Brought to us by David Zoom and his son Brandon Zoom.
Good enough. Bye, everyone.
Bye.